happy moment to be back in the JNTU club and to speak to you all. I know that you have been beaten black and blue since the morning in your classrooms, and again being beaten in the Software Freedom Day, which is supposed to be a celebration, and I don't see any festive mood nor a celebration mood here, and we are just going ahead and repeating the same old classroom maneuvering, beating you around, so I'm helpless. Maybe you all will have to bear with me for some more time. And I was also a little concerned, maybe I'm not sure who is mentoring this GLUT. I think they need to be taken to task because they haven't made this celebration really lively. How many of you all agree with me? Oh, then I think this is most celebrative activity that is happening, then fine, and I'm happy with it. So it was very pleasing to see the symbolism, and I was really very much inspired and moved with one slogan that was there under your logo. So what is the logo, or what is the slogan that you carry on with your logo? Knowledge meets innovation, right? Knowledge meets innovation. What is innovation? Yeah? What is innovation? What is innovation? Anybody? No internal marks, no assessments. So I'm not your faculty member, I'm your fellow free software activist. So, and I'm here to just discuss with you, and so that let us have a few, let us have some time of fun, okay? So what is innovation?
New ideas which can bring the change in the society.
New ideas which can bring a change in the society. Good. And?
New creation.
New creation, yes. And? What is innovation? What does knowledge meets innovation mean? Why is it that you have just put up knowledge and innovation? I thought that it was a well thought out thing, but I was sitting seriously and trying to understand what is the cognitive appearance of this thing called as knowledge meets innovation. And you all need to understand that innovation is not something new, that we don't really figure out something which does not exist. We only tend to sharpen an idea that we have, improve upon it, collate two or three, four ideas, and completely bring out a result whose functionality is rapidly increased, right? And this is true for any innovation. Even if you were to just go back and just, let us go back and just try to understand what multiplication is. What is multiplication? Product of two numbers? Product of n numbers is multiplication. And now I want a geeky answer. So what is multiplication? Any computer science guys here? IT computer science? Yes. Now what is multiplication? The ball is in your court.
Repetitive addition.
Exactly. It's recursive addition, right? It's just nothing but recursive addition. And what is division? Recursive subtraction, right? Everything boils down to addition and subtraction in this world. So what and all you innovate is nothing but, if you are into computing science, if you are in the digital age, forget about computing science. 15 years back when we started off our journey with the free software movement in this country, we used to speak and boast about computing science, what innovation means in the computing science. So what computing science is something that we used to speak about. But with the kind of a simulation that is going on, and even an electronics and communications engineer is not going to really go and sit on the hardware and work on the thing, do you think that ECE guys will be going into the industry with a soldering rod and working out things? How do you tweak things out? How do you tweak things out? You tweak it out in a simulated environment, right? If it were to be computing science, if it were to be electronics and communications engineering, if it were to be power systems engineering, if it were to be civil engineering, if it were to be geological survey or geospatial data sciences, whatever spatial sciences or whatever field of engineering you're going to go, you are going to do it the digital way. And today, I'm just here to scare you all with a dangerous thing that is happening in the country. There's a demon that was trying to come into this nation, which we drove it away in 2005, and it is very bad in a big way. It is back in a very bad way, which is going to just kill innovation. It is going to just kill innovation in this country, and henceforth, the free software movement of India has decided that this period of the Software Freedom Day celebrations. Software Freedom Day celebrations happen globally in the September 15th. But what we have decided was the we have an Engineers Day in this country, and also Gandhi Jayanti on October 2nd. So this whole spell of the period between September 15th and October 2nd, Free Software Movement of India celebrates Software Freedom Fortnight across the country. So this time we thought that wherever we get a chance, wherever we get young ignited minds, we're just going to go there, scare them off, bomb them and just move on. Without which the future of the country is at stake. And it's not any political public meeting that you are here. Neither am I a politician coming here and speaking. And this is something to do seriously with our examples, with our future of our life also. How many of you all think that patents are good? One person is going to say that patenting is good, and I'm proud of this group, either because most of you are already converts, that you're all free software activists, you're geeks here, hence you criticize and you don't like patenting. But at least I would like to just continue my discourse on this, that the software patenting is back in this country, and unfortunately, to be able to tell you and to be more clear of what am I saying, you see, there is a law in this country which has to be executed. As if you have a formula and you're just going to implement it, you have a core formula, a Foster form, and then you derive a circuit and then build an electronic circuit, right? So there's a law and a set of procedures to implement a law. So the law says that there is no software patenting in this country, but the procedures that have been done by the bureaucrats have come out and they are saying that software can be patented now. So this is the fundamental issue that I'm going to raise. Why is software patenting disastrous in a digital age? And I think Mr. Srinivasrao was saying here, I wish he would have been here for this talk. He made a very important statement while he was speaking. He was saying that any field of engineering boils down to what? Representation of mathematical ideas, right? Anything boils down to representation of mathematical ideas. Now, what is the problem if software is patented? We need to just go back and just try to understand what all this jargon means. It is something new. As I said, I promised you that I'm going to bomb you all with this new vocabulary. And what does software patenting essentially mean? What does a patent mean? A patent can be had. I'll just go back to this example of your MCET examination. Why have you written this MCET examination? You got your intermediate pass marks, right? Forget about the critique of the existing system, but why did you write an MCET examination? Because you wanted to be a technologist? You want to be an engineer? Engineer is nothing but being a technologist. You are just trying, the test was intended to figure out, from all the people who read, how many of them are capable of implementing those formulae to derive a technology. How do you implement a science formulae and you derive a product out of it? That is technology. Implementation of science is technology. If science was to be the idea, the instance of an idea is technology. If E is equal to MC square is science, atom bomb is the technology. Nuclear power is the technology. Similarly, if I were to say that GPS is a science, using it in the mobile phone for navigation is technology. So the application of fundamentally science is technology. And when we were to go to computing science, why is it that patenting is allowed in other fields and why not in computing science? Because computing science is nothing but basically, it again boils down to ideas and mathematical formulae. So an idea and an instance of an idea, let us just go back and have a clear understanding of the same thing that which I was trying to explain you a little. When I say idea and an instance of an idea, what is an idea and what is an instance of an idea? I still see half of them sleeping. So let us get back to what are the films these days about, including Bahubali? What essentially transpired in a film? A love story, right? A boy and a girl fall in love and they get married. This is all about a love story, right? So a love story is an idea. You got it? And a boy from JNTU Hyderabad, studying from Karimnagar, a girl from JNTU Hyderabad, coming from Vijayawada, they finish their disciplines of BTech here, they go to US and join, land up in the same university. They study there and they settle in Japan and marry in UK. So this is an instance of an idea, you got it, right? A love story is an idea. An instance of an idea is a derivative of it. So how do you, what is an instance of an idea? So if you were to ask you, what is the story of Bahubali, you would say, the story of the film X, a part of Patalavairavi, a part of this, a part of that, and that's the end of it. If you were to ask you any other movie, Bale Bale Magadi Boy, what is the story all about? It's a part of the film from so and so period, a part of the film. Why is it that, in spite of the best brains that we have in this country, why is it that there is no new love story coming out? Has love died down? It's not the case. But why is it that the thing that really caters to the young minds, the largest market that would be going to the films from a business perspective, still has got, is dwarfed up with a limited number of stories? The total number of instances of this idea from the film critics, I'm not a good film critic at all. So I watch films, but I'm not a good critic of them. But the film critics have come to a common understanding saying that there can be only 36 instances of a love story. 36 instances of a love story. You cannot write any love story without a combination of these 36 instances. So this is the limitation of the path of an art where you need to be derive it and then you put it onto. And let us see what is going to happen with software patents. I am going to just shoot on a very stupid question to you all. How many of you all have used a Dropbox menu in the websites? Everybody, right? It's really a stupid question. Everybody uses it. When you click on the Dropbox menu, what happens? It comes down. When you're registering it, you have n number of things that come in, and you have got a whole list of things, then you come down and click onto it. And also, a side menu bar, when you click on this, it just moves like this, and you have a list of all those things, and you click on that, right? So that is nothing but a technique of web programming. So if I say, if I come out and say that, look, this is the best innovation that I have done. This is the best innovation that I have done, and I'm going to patent this, and anybody who is going to use this as a technology, this code will have to pay me royalty because that is my innovation. Because it is my innovation, if you are going to do a business modeling tomorrow, you are going to develop a website for JNTU Hyderabad for doing something else, or if you are going to work in a company and you just have, your cousin has a departmental store, or your uncle has a departmental store, or he has got something to be sold as a merchandise, and you are going to go and sit and write a piece of code, and you need to pay me royalty for using this in any point of time. How many ways can you do it? Either write it in any of the things. What essentially is it? It is nothing but the DFS and the BFS algorithms, right? The depth first search and the breadth first search algorithms. So in computing science, because it is the representation of a mathematical idea or an algorithm, you can never write anything. There cannot be any instance of an idea and an idea. In computing science, there is no case where you can write an instance of an idea and an idea. Both of them actually overlap with each other. If I'm going to ask you, how many ways can you just traverse a tree? Right? How many ways can you write a program? One is using recursion, the other is using without a recursion. Beyond that, do you think any way that you can do it? And not just I'm going to throw a problem to you. You're going to just write a search engine for JNTU. When you go there and you're going to use search, essentially you're going to search a tree. The data is nothing but it's in the form of a tree, either a binary tree or not a binary tree. It makes no sense. It's a form of a tree. So you either use this algorithm, there's no other way doing it. And today, you all need to understand the most disastrous thing. How many of you all have engaged in procuring things online? At least a railway reservation ticket? Everyone, right? So you do a one-click install. You just say one-click purchase mechanism, right? It's a business method. You go onto the website. You look for certain merchandise. It's one-click install, one-click purchases. This has been patented by Amazon. Amazon could not sue Indian entrepreneurs. Amazon could not sue Indian startups because software patenting was illegal in India. So even if you are going to be innovative and if you have really discovered something new, because you are patent and you had a patent for it, because it needs to work on an ecosystem, right? It needs to work on an operating system. It needs to work on an embedded system. So it means that your patent would be taken off by a big company and then we all would be taken out. So what would happen? It would only ensure that three or four large giant corporations exist. They finish off all the innovation that we have, and that's going to basically take away innovation. And it is something as stupid as me paying my mathematics teacher who taught me mathematics, who taught me addition, and if he comes to me and says that, if my mathematics teacher would have come to me and said that, look Kiran, I have taught you mathematics, and forget about all mathematics, I taught you addition and subtraction. These are the two fundamental things that I have taught. Every time you add something in your life, or you subtract something in your life, you just pay me 1/1,000,000th of a paise. What would be my fate? Yes, I am safe as and long I am a wanderer in the forest. I pluck one fruit and eat it. There is no addition, endorsement, subtraction. And it's only the way I can survive is if I am a wanderer. I am just going to the forest and I ate myself up and live in the forest and just pluck the food that is required for me. It's only the way that I can survive. How many times do you think that an agricultural laborer working in the remotest of the country, part of the country, who does not have a mobile phone, use addition and subtraction? He works for 8 hours a day in the farm, collects his money in the evening, then starts his problem. He goes to the retail outlet in his village, Badigotlandarga, small kirana shop. He goes there, he purchases his daily ration. He gives the note to him, takes the money back, then goes home, tells his wife that this portion for this period, this portion for this period, and this portion for this period, 3 days in the life, three portions in the day. So that is how the discussion goes on. An agricultural worker uses addition and subtraction at least 20 times in a day. What about if I am using a calculator? If it is a 32-bit calculator, same. If it's a hexadecimal calculator, 16 zeros plus 16 zeros, how many times it goes on? And if I am using a computer, just switch it on, how many binary additions and subtractions would have happened by the time it boots up? 1 billion times. So the more tech savvy I am going to be, the more disastrous it is going to be. So it means for me to be on the safer side, software patents are something that have to be kept at bay. And if JNTU Club really believes in knowledge meeting innovation, we need to understand that knowledge is only incremental in nature. The evolution of knowledge has always been incremental in nature. If you were to just go back and look at some historical examples also, the limitations of the existing science, which have been challenged historically, only led to new discoveries and innovations. What made the modern periodic table? The modern periodic table only was derived because you challenged the Mendeleev's periodic table. When you challenge the Dalton's atomic theory, we came into the feelings of the modern atomic theory. When you challenge the conventional file systems, we got into the RDBMS. When you challenge the RDBMS, you have just got onto the object-oriented database management systems. So when you challenge the limitations of the existing, is only when the science develops and science advances. So science only essentially advances historically also. Historically, science has been only advancing in that way. You challenge the existing and when the knowledge is open. And there's a one popular case that I want to bring to your notice. What would happen? Who invented steam engine? James Watt, right? James Watt had the patent for 20 years and he kept on the patent going on for 20 more years. So he had the patent in a total of 40 years and the productivity only went up by 4%. The year he lost the software patent, he lost the patent for steam engine, in a span of 1 year, the productivity of this steam engine increased by 200%. So it was exponential. So it means even if I have a patent for an open market, for any other steams or sciences, it is bad for the society.